And welcome to Temple Baptist Church, our Sunday school class here today. And I'm going to throw something out for you today. Those that watch us from home, and if you don't have a copy of our Sunday school literature to follow along with us, we would be glad to send you one. Our address is Temple Baptist Church, 1813 Barron Road, Poplar Bluff, Missouri, 63901. If you'll just send us your name and address, we'd be glad to get a book to you. You can have a current, we'll keep track of your address, and we'll send you a book on a quarterly basis so you can do that. We're in the book of Hosea again today. We're in chapter 6 and then some out of chapter 7. And, it's talking about the hollow promises. That's the title of the lesson, hollow promises. And, you know, God, and not only God, I think a lot of people despise false repentance. They delight instead in undivided loyalty. God wants us to be loyal. When we think about being loyal, we want our friends to keep their word, don't we? We want the true friend, we want them to be dependable. We want them to be respectful. We want them to be gracious. And in turn, on the other side of that, our friends should be able to expect the same thing from us. Should they not? They ought to be able to do that. And why would it be different when it comes to God? You know, God remains loyal to His people, and He expects them to remain loyal to Him in return. That's nothing that really should surprise us as God's people and the thing we do. But, you know, in this Hosea, it's a, you know, the previous lessons, and I may just mention a few things here. I'm not sure we need to go into a lot of it, you know. The context of his ministry during he's in the later years of the northern kingdom of Israel. And so there it is. And, chapter 3 actually ends with a message of hope that God would send a Messiah who would gather all the true children of God. And in chapter 4 and 5, snaps the reader back to reality. I don't know if you've ever watched shows like that where, you know, they're in today and then in just a minute they're back here and then they're fast forward a little bit to something else and what's going to happen. But, you know, but snap the reader back to the reality of Israel's unfaithfulness to God. You know, the sins of Israel are present as God is pleading a court case. He's doing that. And, you know, the Lord is describing in this in chapter 4 and verse 2, the land is filled with cursing, lying, murder, stealing, and adultery. Does that sound familiar to you today? Does that sound familiar as to what the land is doing today? You know, he laid a lot of the problems at the feet of the priest in chapter 4. That the priest had gone after money and pleasure, and all the people had followed them. Itching ears that the Bible talks about. And all these immoral actions resulted from Israel's pursuit of a fertility god, the high places of Israel. And Hosea is going to warn him in 4:14 of a day when God was going to carry them away into exile. I'm sorry, that's chapter 4, verses 15 and 19. And so in chapter 5, as we're getting up to this, God spoke directly against the priests in Israel. They were like those who removed boundary markers, calling right what was really wrong. How about, does that not fit today's society? Does that not fit America today? Calling things right, which were really wrong. No matter what we call it, is what God's Word says. We can call it whatever we want to, but God's Word says it is wrong. And, you know, God was going to come to them as a lion ready to devour his prey. That's in chapter 5 and verse 14. And he's going to carry them off into exile. And chapter 4 and 5 here really paints a grim picture of Israel's unfaithfulness. And in chapter 7 details more of Israel's corruption. And so when we tucked in between all this that I'm talking about here, these chapters, you know, are the chapters that call for repentance. Hosea chapter 6 and verse 1, where we're going to start out, and then in chapter 7 verse 2 that we're going to look at in that. And, this message of hope farmed the heart of Hosea's message. That's what he's wanting them to do. And so let's get into the text. And again, if you'll write us and let us know you don't have a book, we'll get you one. But it says, come and let us return to the Lord, for he hath torn and he will heal. He has smitten, and he will bind us up. After 2 days, he will revive us again, and the third day, we will raise us up. We shall live in his sight. Then shall we know, if we follow one to know the Lord, he is going forth to prepare us the morning, and he shall come unto us as the rain, as the later and former rain unto the earth. The writer points out here that about, ask the question about who's speaking the words here. Come and let us return to the Lord. And some say that it's Hosea, the one who's speaking on behalf of God and, you know, inviting the unfaithful Israelites to turn to the Lord. And, you know, some think it's a, believe it represents the word of some wayward religious leader on behalf of Israel. And I think if that was the case, it would not be a true call to repentance, but a hollow promise. It's the only, that only left the Lord, you know, he was not happy with them. And what would God do to those people who constantly promised to return to him, but never did? You know, and so I think it doesn't matter who's speaking here. What matters is, and I believe it's Hosea speaking to the children of Israel, but what does it matter? It matters is that it's God's word. It is directed to his people, and he's telling them they need to repent and return to him, or else things are going to happen. If Israel returns to the Lord, he's going to do three things for them. First of all, he's going to heal their wounds. And notice that these wounds affected by God, he had torn them, and these wounds were a result of God's discipline in their life. But now the discipline not merely weren't to wound them, but the purpose was to bring healing, to bring them back to God. That's it. You know, these words build an image where God is characterized as a lion, and he's characterized as a lion tearing his prey into pieces and carrying it to a place no one knows. However, the wounding is going to lead the nation to search for him in their distress. And so second, God has promised to bind up the wounds of those who had wounded. Third, he would revive them. And this would occur after 2 days. And the third day, he would raise them up again. They did not just need healing alone. They needed a resurrection. And we know that, you know, Paul talks about that in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, about the true reality of the resurrection. And in Hosea, is probably meant that Israel would be a short time in exile, and we know how long they were in exile. And as a resurrection nation, when the people returned from the time of discipline, they were going to be able to live in his sight. We want to live in God's sight. We want to live and do right. Repent of our sins. Repent of those things that we do wrong. You know, Jesus told his disciples he was going to be killed and raised up the third day, didn't he? Paul also wrote to the First Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 and 17, to those there who were questioning whether there was a resurrection. He said, the Lord himself is going to send with a shout from the voice of the archangel, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up to him. You know, so I think in verse 2 there, Hosea is providing a partial glimpse of how God will restore his people and how he's going to bring about salvation to the ends of the earth through the Lord Jesus Christ. He's done that. We know that. He has brought that to an end. Our sins have been forgiven if we accept Christ as personal Savior. We still need to repent because I'm still in human flesh and I do things wrong. But verse 3, as we look at it, maybe a little closer, then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord. His going forth is preparing as the morning, and he shall come unto us as the rain, and the later and former rains unto the earth. You know, again, verse 1 has exalted them to return to the Lord. And here's the exhortation, is to follow on to know the Lord. Return to the Lord and strive to know him. And you do that, it's going to usher in a new day for Israel. The Lord's return would be as refreshing as a rain on a barren land. I know we're in a drought situation right now, and so it would really be refreshing. And he would come to them as the rain that waters the earth in a season of drought. And, you know, he, again, Hosea is getting on to the children of Israel, telling them that they have no knowledge of God in the land. Does that not describe America a lot today? No knowledge of God whatsoever. You know, they had no knowledge of his knowledge of his presence. He said he's going forth to prepare as the morning, as surely as the sun rose each day, and it does. God was among his people, and he is. God is always among his people. However, they did not acknowledge his presence. They didn't even say, oh, I guess God exists. You know, they weren't doing that. They lived the way they wanted to live. And how many times do we see that today? Well, I'm going to live the way I want to live. It's, you know, I'm not hurting anybody, so I'm going to do that. Well, that's not true, that we're not hurting anybody. But anyhow, you know, they just didn't acknowledge him in their presence. They lived the way they wanted to live. But God's people need to return to them. Now we look at verse 4 through 6. And, O Ephraim, what shall I do unto thee? O Judah, what shall I do unto thee? For your goodness is as a morning cloud, as in the early dew it goeth away. Therefore I have hewed them by the prophets. I have slain them with the sword of my mouth, and their judgments are as the light that goeth forth. For I desire mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God is more than burnt offerings. Now, I want to hammer on that a little bit here in just a minute about that. You know, but what the prophet is doing here, he's describing the faithfulness of God's people as a morning cloud and an early dew. You know, the morning, the dew, it just appears for a moment, then it's gone. And it, just as Israel's repentance would appear for a moment, you know, they didn't have a what we'd call a, maybe a relapse. Well, I'm going to repent. No, no, I don't want to do that. You know, it just lasted for a moment, and then it'd be gone. And, you know, the other hollow promises of repentance to God. And it's just the point that he said, what shall I do unto thee? He had reached, I guess we could say he reached the end of his rope, and God's rope is long. So you got to look at that. You know, this is a sound of a parent to me whose heart is broken because of a rebellious child. God's children, his chosen people, the nation of Israel, were rebellious against him, and it's breaking his heart. Just as our hearts are broken if our children rebel against us or against God, you know, because the people often empty and broken promise, he's going to take action against them. And here, then by the prophet, he said, slay them by the word from his mouth. You know, reading this, the prophet is not always pleasant experience, but because, and again, it's like watching a parent and a child. The judgment of God is a light that goes forth, is swift and often without much warning. But I think we already know, you know, I'll put this in, if I'm driving above the speed limit and a highway patrolman stops me, I don't need a warning because I already knew what the speed limit was. And we already know what God's expectation of us is. So we really don't need a warning. You know, he said, he speaks on behalf of God, I desire mercy and not sacrifices. And he also said he wanted the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings. Now, mercy was a strong word. It is a strong word, meaning conventional faithfulness. Faithfulness, it's the heart of a relationship between God and his people. God desires a relationship above rituals. There was not an outright denial of the useful sacrifices which were being practiced, but rather it is a condemnation of empty rituals and hollow promises of repentance. Now, Jesus had an encounter with the Pharisees, and as he was eating with tax collectors and sinners, and he said he desired to represent a relationship with sinners who repent and turn to him more than he did hollow religious practices people observe for the sake of ritualism. Now, you think, you ask yourself, do we not do that sometimes? Yes, we do. We practice ritualism, think we're honoring God, and we're just following a ritual that we've been told to do. And there's, you know, if it's not in God's Word, don't worry about it. God's Word is what counts. If I go back to say, you know, and talk about whether Hosea or somebody else was speaking this, it doesn't matter. It's God's Word. He's the one doing it. But we're going on now in chapter 6, and we'll get verse 7, and then we'll get in chapter 7, and we'll get, I'll go through 7 through 11, and then we'll get chapter 7, verses 1 and 2. But they, like men, have transgressed the covenant. There have they delayed treachery against me. Gilead is a city of them that worketh iniquity, as is polluted with blood. And as troops of robbers wait for men, so the company of priests murder in the way by consent, for they commit lewdness. I have a horrible thing in the house of Israel. There is the whoredom of Ephraim. Israel is defiled. O Judah, he has set a harvest for thee. I will return, the captive of my people. Now that finishes up chapter 6 there, and we'll say a little bit about that. The hollow promises that led to broken loyalty with the Lord and resulted in the judgment against God's people. And I think he put that in a nutshell as a story of humanity with the necessity, need for a Savior. They couldn't do it themselves, and we cannot save ourselves. We have to have the blood of Jesus Christ, accept him as our Lord and Savior. But Hosea, he's saying here that the action of God's people were like men, like the world. Some believe, maybe this is the first man, Adam, who broke fellowship with God in the beginning, and Israel had broken a covenant with God in Hosea's day. And they had done this knowingly and deliberately. And, we can go into the account there of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, but we're not going to do that right now. And so Hosea is indicated Gilead as a city of them that work iniquity and is polluted with blood. And that can have some references back to some other things. And another city here was Shechem, where even the priests committed murder in the way. This was the place that had defiled Jacob's daughter Diana. It was there that Simeon and Levi took advantage of the people. The lawlessness of Hosea's day were the signs that the people of God had abandoned their loyalty to him, and it was time for judgment to fall. It's going to fall. Yet judgment was not without mercy. God said he would restore his people and heal Israel. He did not punish them to destroy them, but to heal them. And again, I go back to a parent, a loving parent and a child. They discipline that child because they love them and they want them to know right from wrong. You've heard the old saying that, dad would whip me and said, it hurts me more than it does you. Well, that's not true. But maybe it is. I don't know. It does bother you when we have to discipline our children. And, if left unpunished, this nation would have destroyed themselves. But God, in his mercy, sends them into exile so they would begin to seek him in their shame and separation. If God did not love them, he would have left them alone in their sin. If God did not love us, he would have not gave his only begotten son as payment for our sin debt. Sin debt that we could not pay. A sin debt that we owed. And so we just have to think about it. Judah, this northern kingdom and Samaria and all those people, the people committed falsehood. What they were doing, in fact, their whole lives was a fraud, a promise to repent and turn to God, but continued to live in the brokenness of their own sin. They just continued that. They're broken, it appeared, both in the city and outside the city. If the thief, the thief cometh in, they were willing to steal from one another. No respect for anything outside. People of God were making the lives of their neighboring cities miserable. God's people aren't not to do that. We are to make people around us happy. So whether it was inside or outside the city, their action revealed that they had not truly repented. And then God would remember all their wickedness. Not only did he see their sins, but it was logged in his memory against them. Now, our sins have been forgiven through the blood of Jesus Christ as far as the east is the west. God does have a good memory, but he doesn't bring that up to us. What he's looking at is our present and future. If we commit sin today, we need to repent of that. Say, God, help me. Give me strength not to do that again, that I can keep from doing that. And, and it's logged in his memory. They would not fool God with hollow promises. We can't today. You can't fool God with hollow promise. All the things are there. Their action followed them everywhere they went. Our actions follow us. Everywhere they stepped is an imprint of their disloyalty to God. Where are our footsteps leading us? Are we leading us in a direction that God wants us to go into, or is it our disloyalty to God? Far from hiding their sins from God, their sins was before His face. Now, I can hide things from you, but I shouldn't do those if I've got to hide them from somebody. And so, you know, God knows everything. God sees our sin and is justified in executing judgment for our sin. That's why we need a Savior who can bear our sins for us. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. You know, He's going to bear our sins. We need more than hollow promise. Just those hollow promises don't do any good. We need to, and I'm going to use this word, we just need to try harder or do better. Let's do better. Let's do better. We need to turn from a sin relationship with the God who created us. Well, there's the lesson. There's, to me, the high point of it is that, you know, God sees us. God knows us. God will discipline us if we're not following His directions. And so, you know, just apply this to our lives today. Apply what Hosea is saying here to the United States today and see how much they compare, how they parallel each other, the things that are happening today. And, you know, by the grace of God and the mercy of God, the United States is still a free country, but we need to, as a Christian people, as God's chosen people, as His church, get on our knees and pray for repentance of America. Again, I encourage you to write us. Our address is Temple Baptist Church, 1813 Barron Road in Poplar Bluff, and we will send you a copy of our Sunday school literature, and we'll keep you up to date on it. May God bless you is our prayer.